Scientists love a good mystery, and in current astrophysics, one of the biggest remaining questions is, why is the corona of the Sun so intensely hot? While the surface of the Sun is about 5,500 degrees Celsius, the corona, the atmosphere of the Sun, has a temperature of 1 million up to 3 million degrees Celsius. And so far, scientists haven't quite found out why that is. That the Sun is hot is not surprising. Every second, the Sun's core fuses about 600 million tons of hydrogen atoms into helium atoms under enormous pressure and temperature. And this process of nuclear fusion converts 4 million tons of matter into energy every single second. Because of how dense the plasma that makes up the Sun is, this energy can take anywhere from 100,000 years up to 50 million years to travel through the inner layers of our star, to then finally be released into space, travel a few million miles and reach a small blue world full of living beings that couldn't exist without this energy. Next time you sit outside enjoying some sunshine, know that some of these photons have been underway for longer than all of recorded history, longer than humans have been around for, and some even since around the time the Himalayas began to form when the Indian subcontinent collided with Asia. From the solar core, photons go on a bumpy ride through the radiation zone, the convection zone, and finally reach the photosphere, the visible part of the Sun that has this granular appearance because the plasma moves in currents in the convection zone, kind of like boiling water, or a lava lamp. The temperature of the Sun goes from 15 million degrees Celsius at the core down to only about 5,000 degrees Celsius at the surface. Sunspots in the photosphere caused by fluctuations in the magnetic field of the Sun can be as cold, relatively speaking, as 3,000 degrees Celsius, and that's why they appear darker than the surrounding area. The corona of the Sun then, for some reason, becomes incredibly hot. Corona is Latin for crown, and that's for sure a good name for it. Normally, it's invisible because the light of the Sun outshines it, but you can spot it during a total solar eclipse, during the short amount of time the Moon completely covers the Sun. This is the only time during an eclipse that you can look at it without eye protection. The size and shape of the corona changes with the solar cycle, the 11-year period during which solar activity waxes and wanes. This April 8, 2024, you can see a total solar eclipse over parts of Mexico, the United States, and Canada. And since this year is a solar maximum year, the corona is going to be absolutely spectacular. I wish I could go, but I'm in Belgium and it's far and expensive, so yeah. What can you do? Now, if you can go, I really do recommend it. I was lucky that I saw the total solar eclipse that went over Europe on August 11 in 1999, and it was just nothing short of amazing. Eclipses are actually not that uncommon. Partial eclipses happen twice a year and total eclipses every 18 months. But in any given place, it may happen only once every few centuries. Because the orbit of the Moon is elliptical and slightly tilted, its shadow usually misses the Earth. If it had been perfectly in line with the Earth's orbit and perfectly circular, we would have a total eclipse every month during new moon. Now you can imagine our ancestors didn't have the means or knowledge to truly understand what an eclipse is and that it's completely harmless if one happens only once every few hundred years. Eclipses were often seen as signs of impending doom, distraught gods, calamities galore, and it must have been pretty frightening to have the sky suddenly go dark when you're just out and about gathering berries or herding sheep or something. So you can say we're lucky to be alive today, and not just because science has advanced so much that an eclipse is almost like a celebration of heavenly phenomena. It's relatively easy to be an eclipse chaser because we have so much knowledge of the Sun-Earth-Moon dynamic, but more importantly, it's never been easier to travel all across the world. If you have the time and money for it, that is. We're also lucky to be alive in this particular epoch of Earth's history, which goes back some 4.5 billion years. When the Earth and Moon were still young, the Moon orbited much closer to Earth, and so it would have covered pretty much all of the Sun and the corona during an eclipse. But the Moon slowly drifts away at about 3.8 centimeters per year. Millions of years into the future, the Moon will be too far away for total solar eclipses as we know them. Really, we're fortunate to live in an era that the Sun and Moon's apparent size in the sky overlap almost perfectly. Sometimes when the Moon is at its farthest in its elliptical orbit, apogee, it's already smaller than the Sun's apparent size. So a total solar eclipse truly is a rare and precious occurrence. In the past, scientists had no choice but to wait for a total solar eclipse to see and study the sun's corona. But nowadays we have the coronagraph, a specialized instrument that mimics the effect of a total eclipse, and so that makes it much easier to investigate the solar atmosphere. There's also currently several satellites and observatories out in space collecting data on the sun's activity and properties and all the physics that make our star tick. And so we have a pretty good idea of what goes on with the sun. This gigantic near-perfect sphere of dynamic plasma with a naturally occurring thermonuclear reactor at its heart, and an extremely powerful magnetic field to stir up all sorts of fascinating phenomena like sunspots, coronal loops, solar prominences, solar flares, and coronal mass ejections. I have a whole video on all of these and what effects they can have on Earth, so check that out if you haven't already. The corona itself being so hot makes no sense according to the second law of thermodynamics, which is essentially about the entropy in a given system of particles, and so what matters here is that heat always flows spontaneously from hotter areas to colder areas until the system is in equilibrium, balanced out. So going by this law, you'd expect the heat of the sun to flow out into space and disperse, but instead the corona gets many, many times hotter than the solar surface. This would be something like the air around a light bulb becoming much hotter than the glass of the bulb itself. There must be some unknown process going on here that heats the corona to these incredibly high temperatures. Scientists have been investigating this problem for decades, and they have come up with a couple of possible solutions, but it's still a major challenge to find out which is really actually correct. Currently, there's two theories that seem most likely to be right: wave heating and magnetic reconnection. Wave heating essentially means that waves in the sun's plasma, which are similar to sound waves in air, carry energy from the solar interior to the surface and into the corona. The two types of waves that seem to matter the most here are so-called magnetoacoustic waves and Alphen waves. Magnetoacoustic waves come from the interactions between an electrically conducting fluid, in this case the sun's plasma, and a magnetic field, keeping in mind the sun has a very powerful one. Alphen waves are caused by the back and forth motions of charged atoms and the magnetic fields occurring in the sun's plasma. So lots of wiggling going on, basically. Both types of waves can be launched by the turbulence of the granulation, you know, that lava lamp motion in the sun's plasma, and then carry that energy for some distance into the corona before they release that energy as heat. But the problem with this theory is that it seems that neither wave can carry enough energy into the corona to explain all the heating that is going on here. Now, some data suggests that wave heating may be at least partially responsible for the hot corona, but as it is, more research is still needed. The magnetic reconnection theory poses that the heating comes from the sun's magnetic field constantly getting rearranged because of how magnetic fields behave in electrically conducting plasma. It's also theorized that this effect is what causes solar flares. You get this buildup of magnetic energy which speeds charged particles up in the solar atmosphere, but when that magnetic field collapses and reconnects, this releases all the stored energy and accelerated particles in one big explosion. Now, because solar flares are a local phenomena, they can't be responsible for heating the entire corona more or less evenly. It has been observed that the sun's entire surface is covered with millions of small magnetized regions between 50 to 1,000 kilometers across, and all these little magnetic fields are stirred and churned by the lava lamp motion, and so the idea is then that the magnetic field in the solar corona is constantly reconnecting along with the motion of this magnetic carpet of sorts. This may cause many, many tiny solar flares to happen all across the solar surface all the time. And while these microflares don't release enough energy on their own to explain coronal heating, when a whole lot of them happen all the time, that might actually be the solution to the problem we're facing here. So far, there have not been enough observations of these tiny solar flares to make this the one true explanation that we're looking for. So for now, the mystery remains unsolved. At least until scientists can gather more data so they can be absolutely sure of what the true explanation is, or it may even be a combination of several ideas. Science is a slower process than we would often like, but true progress can only happen if we take the time to make sure our theories and discoveries are true by all objective standards. And that doesn't happen overnight. Our ancestors worshipped plenty of solar deities, and we can all recognize that the sun is what makes life possible on our small planet. Still, despite decades of research and observations with some of the most advanced telescopes and machines on Earth and out in space, our star remains at times almost as mysterious as one of the many sun gods of old. I have a couple other videos about the sun and solar activity for you to watch if you're curious about that, because you can always learn something new, and I sure hope that was the case today. If you're going to go see the solar eclipse, I wish you clear skies. If you're watching this after the event, I hope it was as amazing as I promised it would be, and if you did not have clear skies, I'm sorry that happened. That's very unfortunate. Thanks for watching, and until next time.